Very good morning, friends, and I welcome all of you to the session 5 of the module 1 of the course Analog Electronics. So in today's session, or the learning objective for session 5 is, you will basically be introduced to the need for, what is the need for the transistor biasing. And you will have also have an understanding on the BJT biasing circuits. And we will see how a BJT transistor can be used to make an amplifier. And and also you will get an understanding of how to obtain linear amplification from the fundamentally non-linear bipolar transistor. Okay. So let's first start with what is biasing and what is the need for biasing. Okay. So the focus here is basically on the application of the transistor as an amplifier. Okay. Why do we require the signal amplification? Okay. So signal amplification is the simplest and most important signal processing a task, and it is essential because of the weak signal available at the from the transducer. So such signals are too small for a reliable processing of the information, and the signal magnitude should be large enough to it should be large enough for easy signal processing without any error. Okay, and the majority of the amplifiers are primarily intended to operate on a very small input signal. And the objective is to make the signal magnitude larger, and therefore there is a need for the voltage amplifiers. And these amplifiers are also known as the small signal voltage amplifiers. And with the help of the transistors, okay, we can design the small signal voltage amplifier circuits. But the transistors need to be properly biased, and also it needs to be coupled with the input signal, and also the output should be, the output across the load should be properly coupled, so that you will be able to practically realize a very good amplifier circuit. Okay, and so the functional block that accomplishes the task of the signal amplification is called as the amplifier. Okay, and one of the basic feature of the amplifier is the output waveform must be identical in nature to the input waveform, and the amplifier preserves the details of the signal waveform and any of the deviations of the output waveform from the shape of the input will be considered as a distortion. Okay, so in order to maintain the same shape, okay, but in an amplified manner, or in an amplified version at the output, we need to first have, or this can be accomplished only with the proper biasing of the transistor circuit. So the purpose of the transistor in a transistor amplifier is to set the DC operating point. That is, you need to fix the base current, collector current, and the collector emitter voltage such that the transistor operates in the linear region, okay, which is of prime importance for us in order to obtain the amplification of the signal, okay, so that it operates, so that the transistor operates in the linear region of the output characteristics even after superposition of the AC signal voltage at the base. Both the forward bias voltage at the base emitter junction and the reverse bias voltage at the collector base junction are derived from the single DC supply voltage, what we call as the VCC. Okay. So we define biasing as an external DC voltage that is applied to ensure that the transistor operates in the desired region. Okay, and basically biasing is required to establish a stable Q point, okay, or the stability point, which is Q point is nothing but the IC, ICQ, and VCE. When I say biasing is required to establish a stable Q point, that is ICQ and VCEQ. So in order to ensure biasing also is required to ensure that the transistor remains in the active region. Okay, what I said, that is the linear region. Okay, in order to ensure that the transistor remains in active region for the entire range of the input signal. And it also, you know, and to obtain most appropriate values of IC, IB, and VCE, that represents the quiescent point, okay, or the Q point, what we call as the Q point or the operating point or the quiescent point, operating point or the Q point in the output characteristics of the transistor. So the stability of your system is a measure of, okay, so what is bias stabilization? So let's get a deeper understanding on what is stabilization and what is the stability factor for the circuit. Okay, so the stability of the system is a measure of, when we talk about system here, referring to the amplifier circuit or the amplifier blocks, okay, or the entire transmitter or receiving system. Okay, so the stability of the system is a measure of the network to of a network to variations in its parameters. In any amplifier employing a transistor, the collector current IC is sensitive to each of the following elements, right? We have been discussing in the past a few sessions that there is an influence of the beta factor on IC. There is an influence on temperature. Okay, temperature also has an effect on the collector current. Okay, so in any amplifier employing a transistor, the collector current IC is sensitive to the following parameters, that is beta, that is it increases with IC increases with the increase in temperature, beta, and VBE decreases about 2.5 millivolt per degree centigrade increase in temperature. And then you have the IC vote doubles in every in a value for every 10 degree raise, okay, or 10 degree raise in the temperature, 10 degree Celsius raise in the temperature. Okay, so these three factors can cause the bias point to drift from the designed point of operation. Okay, so as long as you maintain within the bias point or the quiescent point, then the system remains stable. But once you exceed, okay, once there is a drift, once there is a change in these, it could be because of the beta, or it could be because of VBE, or it could be because of the ICO, then the system will become unstable. Okay, so stability of a system is a measure of the network to the variations in the parameter like the beta, VBE, or ICO, which can be influenced by the variation in the temperature. Okay, so stabilization is making the Q point or the quiescent point independent of the changes in the temperature and the changes in the transistor parameters. Okay, so that that is the transistor parameters here is your ICO, VBE, or beta. Okay, so stabilization is making the Q point independent of the changes in the temperature and changes in the transistor parameters. So if ICO and VBE and beta changes simultaneously, then the net, there will be a net influence, or there will be an influence on the current IC. Okay, so your delta C is equal to delta IC by delta ICO. Okay, so our delta IC can be, I can write the equation of delta IC is equal to delta IC by delta ICO into delta ICO plus delta IC into delta by delta VBE into delta VBE and plus delta IC by delta beta into delta beta. Okay. It can be represented. So here delta IC by delta ICO. Okay, this first term. This represents the, this represents the current stability factor. Okay, delta IC by delta ICO. And the second term, okay, delta IC by delta VBE. So this represents the voltage stability factor. And the third parameter or the third component is your, the third term here, okay? That is delta IC by delta beta. So this represents the amplification stability factor, okay? So your delta IC can be influenced by. So our delta IC is nothing but delta IC by delta ICO into delta ICO plus delta IC by delta VBE into delta VBE plus delta IC by delta beta into delta beta. Okay, so where this represents the current stability factor, voltage stability factor, and the amplification stability factor. So the temperature dependence of IC and thermal runaway. Okay, so IC is equal to beta times IB plus 1 plus beta ICBO. So where ICBO is a strong function of the temperature. So a rise of 10 degree centigrade doubles the ICBO and IC, and it will increase. Okay, it is going to increase beta by 1 plus beta times of the ICBO. So the flow of IC produces heat within the transistor, and it raises the transistor temperature further, and thereby, and therefore, it increases in ICBO. So this effect is cumulative, and in few seconds the IC, okay, because IC is nothing but beta times IB plus 1 plus beta ICBO, right? So this becomes, so as this increases or this increases, it's going to cumulatively increase your IC component, right? So this effect is cumulative, and in few seconds the IC may become large enough to burn out the transistor. Okay, so you can see for every 10 degree raise, this is going to double. Okay, so it is going to double the ICBO, and IC will increase 1 plus beta times ICBO. Okay, so this causes the self-destruction of an unstabilized transistor, and this situation is called as the thermal runaway. Okay, so the self-destruction of an unstabilized transistor is known as the thermal runaway state. Okay. And now let's see what is the stability factor. Okay, so stability factor is the rate of change of collector current IC with respect to the collector leakage current ICBO. Okay, this leakage current is a very small part, but still it has an influence, right? It is called as, so the rate of change of collector current with respect to the collector leakage current ICBO is called as the stability factor, and it is denoted by S. Okay, that is S is equal to, so it is going to be defined as DIC by DICBO. So the network that are quite stable and relatively insensitive to the temperature variations have a very low stability factor. Lower the value of S, better the stability of the transistor. Higher the value of the stability factor, the more sensitive is the network to the variations in that parameter. Okay, what are the parameters? It can be your beta, or it can be VBE, or it can be ICBO. Okay, so those are the ones that will affect your stability of the network or stability of your design, okay, network design. So networks that are quite stable and relatively insensitive to the temperature variations have a very low stability factor, and lower the value of S, better is the stability of the transistor. Higher the stability factor, the more sensitive is the transistor to the variations in the parameters. And you also need to note that out of the three stability factors, okay, that is, what are the three stability factors we saw? That is the current stability factor, voltage stability factor, and the amplification stability factor. Those were the three, right? So out of the three stability factor, current stability factor is most sensitive because if S is in tolerance limit, then S dash is your voltage stability, okay, and we represent the amplification stability factor as S double dash. Okay, so S dash, and that is the current stability factor, is most significant because if S is in tolerance limit, the S dash and S double dash are guaranteed to remain in the tolerable limit. Okay, and therefore your S ideal, that is the stability, should be equal to almost 1. Okay, it should be equal to 1, and practically S should be less than 20. Okay, so that is about your stability factor. And we also know that IC is equal to beta times IB plus 1 plus beta ICBO. So differentiating this equation, we get with respect to IC, you get 1 is equal to beta times DIC by DI by DIC plus 1 plus beta DICBO by DIC. Okay. And then you get, okay, here IB is missing, I guess. Okay. So you get I is, so 1 is equal to beta times DIB by DIC. Oh, okay, I think, yeah. B is missing here. Let me correct it. Yeah. And this has to be 1. Yeah. Yes. So differentiating this equation by with respect to IC. So you get DIC by DIC is 1. Is equal to beta times DIB by DIC plus 1 plus beta into DICBO by DIC. So 1 is equal to beta times DIB by DIC plus 1 plus beta by S. Okay, because this is represented by S. DIC by DICO is S. So DICBO by DIC will be 1 by S. Okay, or I can rewrite this, interchanging the terms and rewriting the expression for the stability S here. So S will be equal to 1 plus beta divided by 1 minus, taking this term the other side, it becomes 1 minus beta DIB by DIC. And so it is S is equal to 1 plus beta divided by 1 minus beta times DIB by DIC. Right? Okay, so that is the expression for the stability. Okay, the stability factor or the current stability factor. Now let's see what are the different types of BJT biasing circuits. So as we understood that biasing is very important or is very essential for a stable Q point, that is your ICQ and VCEQ points, and to ensure that the transistor should remain, for amplification purpose, it has to remain in the linear region of operation, or it has to remain in the active region for the entire range of the input signal. And also biasing, that is stabilizing IC and VCE, needs to be done in order to ensure that the transistor remains in the linear region of operation. Okay. And so we have basically four different types of BJT biasing circuit. The fixed bias is the four different biasing circuits are the fixed bias with emitter resistor circuit, and then you have the voltage divider bias circuit and feedback bias circuit, right? So then you have the fixed biased circuit. Let's see each one of them, what fixed bias is, what fixed bias with emitter resistor circuit is, and voltage divider bias circuit, and the feedback bias circuits are. Yeah. So fixed biased, so this is the first biasing circuit, and the transistor arrangement for the fixed bias circuit is as shown here. Okay, so you have the NPN transistor connection shown here. We have a resistor connected to the base, as well as you have a resistor connected to the collector, and then we have a supplies voltage of plus VCC, and then you have through RB you have the current flow IB, and through RC you have the current flow IC, and the voltage across the base emitter is VBE, and the voltage across the collector emitter is VCE. Okay, and this type of an arrangement is known as the base bias, or also it is also called as the base bias circuit, or it is also referred to as the fixed current bias. Okay, so the base current is a constant it is a constant quantity, and it is determined by the supply voltage VCC and the base resistor RB. Okay, and because VCC and RB are constant, IB remains fixed at a particular value. Okay, it remains fixed at a particular value, and the base current in the base bias circuit is not affected by the transistor current gain. So if we observe the voltage drop across RB, okay, the voltage drop across RB will be VCC minus VBE, VCC minus VBE, and so the base current can be calculated as the voltage drop across RB divided by RB. Okay, so that is VCC minus VBE divided by RB. Okay, and the base emitter voltage VBE is taken to be 0.7, and for a silicon transistor, and it is considered to be 0.3 for a germanium device. Okay, and therefore so it can be VCC minus 0.7 divided by RB for the silicon transistor. Okay, and so your VCC is equal to IB RB plus VBE. Since the equation is independent of the current ICR, so DIB by DIC into R is equal to zero, and the stability factor reduces to 1 plus beta. And since beta is a large quantity, this is a very poor biasing circuit, or not suitable for practical applications. Okay, that is because the equation is independent of the ICR. Okay, so if you differentiate DIB by DIC into R, this is going to be zero, or is this going to be 1 plus beta? And since beta is a large quantity, this is very poor biasing circuit and not suitable for a practical application. So for a given transistor, VBE does not vary significantly during the use. As VCC is of a fixed value, on the selection of R, the base current IB is fixed. Therefore, this type of an arrangement is called as the fixed biased type of a circuit. And for the given circuit, VCC is equal to ICRC plus VCE, right? The voltage across collector emitter plus the drop across RC will be equal to VCC. Okay, and therefore VCE will be equal to VCC minus ICRC. Okay, so now let's see the advantages and disadvantages of the fixed bias. Some of the major advantage of fixed bias circuit is, by merely changing the base resistor RB, the operating point can be shifted anywhere in the region of in the linear region or in the active region, and number of components required are less for the fixed bias circuit arrangement. Okay, and the disadvantages, as I said, the collector current does not remain constant with variation in temperature or a poor supply voltage. Therefore, the operating point is unstable, and changes in VBE, that is the voltage across the base emitter, will change the base current IB, and thus causes the RE to change, that in turn alters the gain of the circuit or the amplifier. Okay. When the transistor is replaced, the value of beta changes, and this shifts the operating point, and it is again prone to thermal runaway. Okay, that is the drawback of the fixed biased network. Now let's see the second type of an arrangement, that is fixed biased with emitter resistor circuit. Okay, in case of your fixed biased with emitter resistor circuit, we have emitter resistance. Okay, the change that you have incorporated in comparison to the fixed bias circuit is, we have a emitter resistance also connected to the emitter terminal. Okay, So the fixed bias circuit is modified by attaching an external resistor to the emitter, and this resistor RE, it will introduce a negative feedback that stabilizes the Q point or the quiescent point. So the voltage across the base resistor will be VCC minus IERE, okay, IERE minus VBE, okay, VCC minus VBE minus IERE, okay. So the base current will be now VRB, okay, VRB divided by RB. So that is the base current. So IB is equal to, so what is VRB? VRB is VCC minus IERE minus VBE. So substituting this here, you get IB is equal to VCC minus VBE divided by RB plus 1 plus beta times RE. So for bias stabilization, RB should be less than beta times RC. So that IC is equal to beta into VCC minus VBE divided by RB plus 1 plus beta times RC. So if RB is less than beta times RC, then your IC or the current through the collector will be VCC minus VBE, okay, VBE divided by RC, okay. So the advantage of the emitter fixed bias with emitter resistor circuit is that the circuit has a tendency to stabilize operating point against the changes in temperature and the beta value. The disadvantage is to keep IC independent of beta, and RE causes AC negative feedback, which reduces the voltage gain of the amplifier. Okay, so in order to keep IC independent of beta, RE causes the AC negative feedback, which reduces the voltage gain of the amplifier. So that is the drawback of the circuit. And then we have the third circuit, that is the voltage divider bias. So this voltage divider bias provides or is a method that is popularly used, okay, to provide biasing. And the voltage divider bias is most stable in comparison to the other biasing circuits, okay. And it is also seen that as the collector resistor, okay, so if you see the change here is you have RB, no longer you only have one resistor, you have RB being replaced by R1 and R2, and then you have an emitter resistor connected to the emitter also, okay, a little change that you see compared to the previous two circuits, okay. So the collector resistor RC, there is an emitter resistor RE connected in series with the transistor. And the total DC load in series with the transistor is RC plus RE. And the total resistance must be used when drawing the DC load line for that circuit. And also you see that resistor R1 R2 constitute the voltage divider that divides the supply voltage to produce the base bias voltage, okay, VB. So voltage divider bias circuit are normally designed to have the voltage divider circuit or current I2, which is larger than the transistor base current IB. And in such a situation, VB is largely unaffected by IB, and so that VB can be assumed to remain a constant. Okay, so that is the advantage. Okay, so in this form of biasing, R1 and R2 divides. So what you understand is, in this form of biasing, R1 and R2 divide the supply voltage VCC and the voltage across R2, provide a fixed base bias VB at the transistor base, and also the resistor RE is included in series with the emitter so that it provides the stabilization, okay, because it provides a negative feedback part. Okay, so you have the voltage across R2 is now VB. Okay, voltage across R2 is VB is equal to VCC into R2 divided by R1 plus R2. Okay, so this is calculated with the help of the Thevenin or the Thevenin equivalent. Okay, so the voltage VB is equal to VThevenin, that is equal to VCC by into R2 by R1 plus R2. How you achieve this is R Thevenin is R1 parallel R2, which is R1 R2 by R1 plus R2. So the base emitter loop or V Thevenin minus IB R Thevenin minus VBE minus 1 plus beta times IB RE is equal to 0, or IB is equal to V Thevenin minus VBE divided by R Thevenin plus 1 plus beta times RE. Okay, so that is the base emitter loop, and the collector emitter loop will be IC is equal to, okay, IC is equal to what? Beta times IB, right? So IB is nothing but V Thevenin minus VBE divided by R Thevenin plus 1 plus beta times RE. So substituting for IB, you get IC is equal to beta times V Thevenin minus VBE divided by R Thevenin plus 1 plus beta times RE. So VCCE, okay, VCE, okay, VCE here, VCE, this voltage across the collector emitter is equal to VCC minus ICRC, right, minus IERE. That is equal to VCC ICRC minus IC plus IB into RE. So for bias stabilization, R Thevenin should be less than 1 plus beta times RE. So IC is equal to V Thevenin minus VBE by RE. So the stability factor for the voltage divider bias is S is equal to 1 plus beta divided by 1 minus beta DIB by DIC. So if you differentiate this equation with respect to IC, okay, and we also know that V Thevenin minus IBR Thevenin minus VBE minus IERE is equal to 0. V Thevenin is equal to IB into R Thevenin minus VBE minus IE is nothing but IB plus IC, right, into RE. So differentiating this with respect to IC, then you get V Thevenin is equal to IB R Thevenin minus VBE minus IB plus IC into RE, or 0 is equal to R Thevenin DIB by DIC plus 1 plus DIB by DIC into RE, or DIB by DIC is equal to minus RE by R Thevenin plus RE. So S is equal to 1 plus beta times R Thevenin plus RE divided by RE into 1 plus beta times plus R Thevenin. That is, S is equal to 1 plus beta into 1 plus R Thevenin by RE divided by 1 plus beta plus R Thevenin by RE. So for stability, S should be small, which can be achieved by making R Thevenin by RE small. For very small R Thevenin by RE, S is equal to 1. That is the ideal case. So for a very small R Thevenin by RE, when R2 decreases, it implies that R Thevenin current drawn by R2 will be large. If RE increases, it implies that large VCC is required, and hence a compromise has to be made in the selection. Okay. And then you have the we'll see what are the advantages and disadvantages of the voltage divider bias. Advantages is, unlike other circuit, only one DC supply is necessary. The operating point is almost independent of beta variation, and the operating point stabilized against a shift in temperature, and due to stability, it is widely used for linear circuits. The disadvantage is to keep IC independent of beta. Okay, that is the major disadvantage. And now let's see how, why we were interested in all the biasing is because we want to use the BJT in the amplification circuit. So BJT as an amplifier is, again, amplification is one of, as I said, is one of the most common application of BJT. And it is a process of linearly increasing. Okay, it is a process of linearly increasing the amplitude of an electrical signal or the information signal. So amplification in a transistor is achieved by passing the input current signal from the region of low resistance to a region of high resistance. Okay. You need to keep in mind that amplification in a transistor is achieved by passing the input current signal from a region of low resistance to a region of high resistance. Okay, so transistor amplifies current because the collector current is equal to the base current multiplied by a factor of the current gain. That is, we have been seeing that IC is equal to beta times IB. Okay, and this shows that is the input signal DC bias. When you apply the DC bias to the transistor, then you have the output signal, which is an amplified version of the input signal. Okay, that's why when you through a microphone and when you hear it through a loudspeaker, the voice is larger. You are able to hear a big loud noise or voice. Okay, so the signal source cannot deliver directly required power to the load. Okay, so this is a simple circuitry for the amplifier. And so you see the input resistance as RS, or the source resistance is RS. Then you are passing it through the amplifier, and the output is taken across the load. Okay, so amplification is required to enhance the signal power, and amplification is one of the major analog signal processing function, right? So again, you have different types of amplifiers. So based on the output power level, you have the pre-amplifiers, which are tuned or wideband, also called as the tuned or the wideband amplifiers. And then you have the power amplifiers, again, which are tuned or wideband amplifiers. And then this is based on the output power levels. It can be based on output power levels, you can have pre-amplifiers or power amplifiers. And based on input and output variable, you can have these four categories. That is the voltage control voltage source. Okay. VCVS, we call it way in short, or it is abbreviated as VCVS. That is the voltage amplifier. And then you have voltage controlled current amplifier, current source. Voltage controlled current source. That is VCCS. That is the transconductance amplifier. And then you have the current controlled voltage source, that is the CCVS, that is the transistor resistance amplifier. And then you have the current controlled current source, that is CCCS, that is the current amplifier. Okay, so based on input and output variables, you have voltage amplifier, transconductance amplifier, voltage amplifier, transconductance amplifier, trans resistance amplifier, and current amplifier, right? And then we have these, what is the difference between the voltage trans impedance and trans admittance and current amplifier is, it is in the, what is, how your input signal looks like and how your output signal will look like, and what is the transfer ratio you're going to get. Okay. That is because amplification is, what I said, low resistance to the high resistance region. So you have voltage amplifier, the input signal is voltage, output signal is also in the form of voltage, and the transfer ratio is in the form of voltage gain. Okay, and then you have the trans impedance amplifier. The current input signal is current, output signal is voltage, and the transfer ratio is trans impedance. Okay, and then you have the trans admittance, where the input signal is a voltage, output signal is a current, and the transfer ratio is trans admittance. For the current amplifiers, the input signal is current, output signal is current, and the transfer ratio is the current gain. Okay, so the task of small signal amplifier is to amplify a weak electrical signal. So this can be in the form of a voltage, or it can be in the form of a current, into a large voltage or a current swing. with the amplitude that becomes adequate of for subsequent signal processing. And this leads and this has led to the classification of the small signal amplifiers into these four possible combinations of input and output signals. Okay, and so the classification is again governed by the nature of input and the output signal. That is, whether it is an voltage or it is a current. And it would be therefore, I mean, the criteria of modeling an electrical signal as a voltage or a current waveform is required. Okay. So this is about the amplifier. And then you again, you have the pre-amplifiers. So when I say pre-amplifier, the signal levels are very low. It can be in pico, micro, millivolts, and again, the conversion can be, okay, you're converting a pico, micro, or millivolts into a pico, micro, or milliamperes. And then enhancing the signal to noise ratio is the primary requirement. And then for a power amplifier, the signal levels are high in terms of voltage and current, and efficiency is the primary requirement again. And for an ideal amplifier, or when do you call it as an ideal amplifier, which has a zero input power and deliver finite output power, providing infinite power gain. Okay, so an ideal power amplifier is which has a zero input power and delivers a finite output power, providing infinite power gain, and which has a input power zero if the input current to the amplifier is zero. That is, I is equal to zero, or the input voltage to the amplifier is a zero. That is, VI is equal to zero. Okay. So an ideal amplifier satisfying any of these. Okay. That is, a zero input power and delivers a finite output power, providing an infinite power gain. And then the second condition is having an input power zero if the input current to the amplifier is zero, or the input voltage to the amplifier is a zero. That is, VI or VI should be zero. Okay. And when it comes to the input and output resistance requirement for the amplifier circuit, so this diagram shows, okay, the signal, okay, or the connection for the current flow. Okay, electrical signal as a current, as we know that we are trying to view the electrical signal as a voltage or a current that needs necessary or remains confined to the transducer, and the output signal of the electrical network when applied across a load to a subsequent electrical network can be modeled as a voltage or a current source, right? Practically the current source can also be conceived by placing an internal resistance, okay, RS, which is in shunt with the ideal current set, okay, current source, and therefore current or it can be in series for a voltage source. Okay, so here, since we have shown a voltage source, it is in series with the placement of RS is in series with the voltage, and would apply an amount the placement of RS in series with VS would aptly account for a measured dependency of external voltage for an external voltage VI. Okay, from the source with the changing load, okay, RI. Okay, so here we have considered the load to be 2.5 kV. And therefore, RL would, say the voltage across RL, that is RI, would be, refer it to as VI, okay? And it would approach VI with RI being very greater than RS, okay? And so therefore, the RI and RS relationship for the voltage amplifiers can be shown here. Okay, so for a voltage amplifier, Ri should be greater than Rs, and R naught and RL relationship. Okay, R naught and RL relationship be such that R naught should be very less than RL. And similarly, for a trans impedance amplifier, Ri should be less than Rs, and R naught should be less than RL. Okay, and for trans admittance amplifier, Ri should be greater than Rs, and R naught should be greater than RL. And for a current amplifier, Ri should be less than Rs, and R naught should be less than should be greater than R naught should be greater than RL. Okay, so this is how the output resistance of the amplifier plays a significant input resistance and the output resistance of the amplifiers plays a significant role in deciding the effective gain of the amplifier. Okay. So this is about the input output resistance of the amplifier. And now let's see the BJT as an amplifier. Okay, so if we observe here, this is the figure shows the non-linear relationship. There is a linear amplification can be obtained by using the technique of biasing in the BJT. Okay, so here if we observe for the circuit, okay, the output voltage is given by, so output voltage is V0, which is equal to VCE. So VCE is nothing but VCC minus ICRC, right? So in active mode, IC is equal to, okay? So this is the linear region of operation, or where amplification, so from 0.3 volts to 0.5 volts, it is in the cutoff mode, and above 0.5, it is in the active mode, and here it is the saturation, right? So in active mode, IC will be equal to IS into e power VBE by VT. So substituting for IC in VCE, we get VCE is equal to VCC minus IC in RC into IS e power VBE by VT. Okay, so note that this expression is a nonlinear relationship, and therefore linear amplification can be obtained by using the technique of the BJT biasing. So biasing to obtain linear amplification, the DC bias point or the quiescent point is the point on the load line which represents the current in the transistor and the voltage of it when no signal is applied. So it represents the DC bias condition, okay, the point of intersection of VCE with the VBE. Okay, so the signal to be amplified, that is VBE, a function of the time t, is superimposed on the bias voltage VBE. So VBE of t is equal to VBE plus VBE of small t. So biasing to therefore you can observe the signal amplification, okay, the input signal amp, the signal to be amplified, that is VCE, a function of the time, is superimposed on the bias voltage VC, and therefore hence you observe the amplification of the signal in the linear region. Okay, so this is the point of intersection of VBE with VCE, and therefore you are able to observe the signal amplification. So now let's see the small signal voltage gain of the BJT amplifier. What is the gain that you achieve? Therefore, the gain is negative, which implies that, okay, so AV is equal to DVCE divided by DVBE, that is equal to minus IC by VT into RC. So the gain is negative, which implies that the amplifier is inverting, and there is a 180 degree phase shift between the input and the output. So the gain is proportional to the collector bias current or collector bias current IC and the load resistance RC. So AV is equal to minus IC RC divided by VT, or it is VC, how do I represent IC RC as VC minus VCE divided by VT, or A max is equal to VCC minus 0.3 divided by VT. Okay, so this is the gain to the collector base current IC and to the load resistor. So locating the bias point, so you can see here IC and VC. So IC is equal to VCC by RC minus 1 by RC into VCE, okay, for a fixed VBE. So this shows your Q point, operating point, maximum and minimum. Okay, the minimum and maximum Q point, or this is the stable region of operation, or where amplification can be obtained. Okay, so if you observe, the purpose of AC amplifier is to produce an output waveform that is amplified version of the input waveform, and you see that in a BJT amplifier, the maximum and minimum output voltages are typically the voltages at the saturation and cutoff regions. Okay, and minimum and the maximum output voltage are limited by the saturation voltage, and the cutoff voltage equal to the supply voltage respectively. And apart from clipping, the degree to which the output waveform has the same slope or the shape as the input depends upon the amplifier's linearity. So to be linear, any change in the output voltage must be directly proportional to the change in the input voltage, and that is created. So the linearity of the transistor can be determined by examining the extent to which the equal increment of the base current corresponds to the equal spaced curve or curves in the CE output characteristics. So any change in the input voltage should cause the output voltage to vary to a proportion extent along with the load line only. And a non-linear amplification due to unequally spaced output characteristics, it may be noted that the distance between the curve increases for large values of base current. And the active region of BJT is again often called as the linear region, because the base current curves are generally found to have nearly equal spacing in this region. And small signal analysis of this device would thus be restricted to a very small range of operation along with the load line. So the DC ground of the circuit remains a point where the DC or the total potential is zero. And the AC ground point, or a point where the AC potential with respect to the DC ground is zero. So the power supply VCC is an AC ground for an AC equivalent circuit, and a mid or a high frequency region of the AC signal, the value of the coupling capacitors that can be used can behave as a short, can also be used as a short circuit for a short term, or a bypass capacitor, or for the short circuits. Okay, and so this is about locating the bias point. And let's quickly try to see your understanding on the topic discussed. The first question would be, transistor biasing represents dash condition, whether it is AC, DC, both AC and DC, or none of the above. And then you have the second question, operating point represent dash, value of IC, VCE when signal is applied, the magnitude of the signal, zero signal values of IC and VCE, and none of the above. So the answer for the first one is DC, and the answer for the second question is zero signal value. Operating point basically represents the zero signal value of IC and VCE. Okay, so let's see the next question. If biasing is not done in an amplifier circuit, it results in decrease in the base current, unfaithful amplification, excessive collector bias, none of the above. And the second question is, for faithful amplification of a transistor circuit, the value of VBE should be dash for a silicon transistor. Should it be 0 or 0.01, or not fall below 0.7, or it should be lie between 0 and 0.1 volts? Okay, so the answer is C, that is, it should lie between 0 and 0.1. And the answer for the Third question is, if biasing is not done in amplifier circuit, it will result in an unfaithful amplification. Okay, and the circuit that provides the best stabilization of operating point is dash, that is base resistor bias, collector feedback bias, potential divider circuit, and none of the above. And then the next question is, for proper operation of transistor, its collector should have dash proper forward bias, proper reverse bias, very small size, none of the above. Okay, so the circuit that provides best stabilization of operating point is the potential divider bias. Okay, and then for proper operation of the transistor, its collector should be a proper reverse bias. Okay, so with this we end session 5. Let's meet for the next session and let's get some more understanding on the small signal amplifier gain. Thank you. Let's meet in session 6.